Goeienaand luisteraars en welkom by ons se koppe by mekaar. As julle nog nie weet nie, is dit die gespreksreeks waar ek Thea Smit en Hans van der Veen en Ronel Lemmer saam praat en ons praat gewoonlik oor COVID-19. Ons is drie sielkundiges en ons sit ons koppe by mekaar, maar vanaand het ons 'n spesiale gas. Voordat ek ons gas voorstel, wil ek net eers sê goeienaand Hans.
Goeienaand Thea, lekker om hier saam met julle te wees. Dit lyk vir my die winter is besig om te draai.
Ja, nee, ons het lekker sneeu gehad en vanaand wil ons ook net sê vir Ronel Lemmer, sy is nie vanaand hier by ons nie, maar ons mis jou Ronel en ons sien uit om weer volgende week jou in die studio te hê. Nou luisteraars, vanaand het ons 'n spesiale gas en dit is meneer Boisa Volpley. Hy is hier van Oudtshoorn, gebore en getoe hier in Oudtshoorn en skool gegaan en hy werk op die oomblik by die Oudtshoorn munisipaliteit, alhoewel vanaand verteenwoordig hy ongelukkig nie vir hulle nie, hy verteenwoordig net homself. Meneer Volpley was 'n lid van die ANC vir al in 2011, maar hy het gesê al wat ek vir hom moet voorstel as is 'n aktivis. So meneer Volpley, welkom. Welkom voor jou so toe ons het koppe by mekaar.
Thank you very much. Let me greet everyone. I'm happy to be here.
Yes, thank you for being here with us. So luisteraars, ons gaan vanaand praat ons met 'n twee tong, 'n Engelsman tong en 'n Afrikaanse tong. So julle moet geduldig wees met ons. Voisa, can you maybe tell the listeners, give us a little background of yourself? Some people might say, no, they don't know you. You've never grown up in Oudtshoorn.
Fortunately, I think most of the people of Oudtshoorn, they would know me. We live in a very small community where everyone knows everyone. And I'm born in this town, in Oudtshoorn Hospital, many years ago.
Yeah.
And I've started school here and left Oudtshoorn, came back. Went to Cape Town and came back after 2007 and become part of this community where I'm born. So I'm an Oudtshoornite, as they say in Afrikaans. I'm from this town. I'm born in this town.
Yeah. And meneer Boisa say for me, I kan dalk nie Afrikaans vlot praat nie, maar julle moet hom nie dink hy kan dit nie verstaan nie. So luisteraars, is that
too. That's correct. Yeah, people that knows me is that the articulation is very difficult, but I work in Düsseldorf and most of the time my Afrikaans has been improved very immensely, but I can even, you know, on the lighter note, have an engagement in Afrikaans, but yeah, so my Afrikaans is just the articulation.
Yes. So tonight, what we want to speak about is especially COVID-19, but also about this topic that has been going on, hashtag Black Lives Matter. So luisteraars, stuur vir ons 'n WhatsApp. As julle nou nie die nommer weet, die nommer is 060-505-2693. En julle kan dit in Afrikaans stuur of in Engels stuur. En gesels 'n bietjie saam oor hierdie topic, Black Lives Matter. Now, Voisa, just before we delve into that topic, what has inspired you to become an activist? Where was the seed planted? How did it happen that you decided to stand up for other people's rights or other people's lives?
Remember, every black child in South Africa, one way or the other, is affected by the political dynamics in growing up, by the apartheid system and all of that sort. So you grow up in an environment that you become politically conscious about your surrounding and what's happening. And therefore, when you take a sober analysis, you would see that you need to participate in why, even if you don't like want to, but the system compels you to be part of that set up of saying there's a system and I need to participate, make sure that we get out of that system. And moreover, I got inspiration when, remember in the 70s when you would you would listen to issue of black power, issue of black consciousness, Steve Biko, and after that, then the politics change, you know. So all of that influences you, how you grow up, and the issue of the apartheid, and that compels you to participate. And therefore, it becomes within you when you're surrounded by people before you that are leadership in showing the way towards emancipation, freedom, and then you could become part of that. I had somebody that also were around us in the township, Ospi Hwodbom, that were activists that were actually in that bonglet of ours that had 8th Street, would teach us to be resistant towards the system. So that's where the inspiration comes from the SIA leadership, you know, Ospi Hwodbom, and all other activists that were in leadership that taught us the way moving forward.
Were you an activist at school already, if I might ask that? Or did you become an activist after school? When did your activism, you know, when did you go over into taking a stand?
Look, you become, if you are at school, I was at school in 1989, 90, I was in high school in Mezabayitu. Luckily, I served in the SRC, student representative police. Yes. So that's where leadership comes from. And in those times, remember before the Mandela was released in 1990, you still have the fight against, you know, the system. And therefore, at school, you're actually compelled, you know, to take part. You know, whether you don't like it or not, you cannot sit in between because the system suppresses you and you take a conscious decision. So I took a conscious decision at that level to be an activist and to participate in the struggle of young people and black people in general.
So did you get to it with the support of your parents or your family? It's just interesting to hear, you know, how did that seed grow?
I had three brothers. People that knows me, you know, I had a father who almost was a polygamist, if you like. So I had a father that had kids. Two of those kids, one of my brother was killed in George, 1985. Osnatiklas was shot. Hmm. And I had two brothers that left and joined the MK, Mkhonto weSizwe. And I had my stepmother, yeah, that actually was the activist. Most people in the region know Mamo Hlazo, you know. So in that setup, you grow up to understand and to be influenced about, you know, the participation into politics, okay. You know, and they get home in that space.
Okay. I'm thinking for you, so was there one specific incident in your life that stood out where you felt unfairness towards you because of your skin color?
It goes without saying. Remember, apartheid was about suppression of black people. And therefore, you actually will feel that. You know, you will sit at home at times in the 80s, and out of the blue, there's quite a lot of policemen that come and kicks the door, you know, and then try to look whatever they're looking for. You know, if you go to a dance in the hall, and there's a stage in the 80s, you dance, and then the police would come in, close the halls, put tear gas inside the hall. And remember, you're sweating, you know, you're dancing, and they just break that. So everyone, and also let me say, everyone, you know, when my brother passed out on 1985, was not, it says something to you, to say, look, it is something that makes you to be rebellious, something that conscientizes you to say, look, this system is not right, because for a person that fights the system, that to be killed. Because when it says of my brother, he left and ran to George, they hunted him down, and he was shot in Lavai. They put him in a van, and then they took him out of the van, they come and they shot him, and they say he was running away, you know. So all of those things, and when my two brothers left and joined Umkhonto weSizwe, Joe Hlazo, all of those things, you know, when they do the raiding of your home, you know, and all of those things, they compelled you, you know, to be to be conscious about the surrounding, conscious about what is happening. And in that score, then you become, you know, you choose whether to be active or to hide under the bed. But of course, the choice would be for you to go and then assist and participate in this revolution is to go out there and be active in the emancipation of our people. So every young child, black child, was compelled to be in that space, you know. Whether, as I'm saying, if you're in school, there's uprising about, you know, the system where you students struggles around fighting apartheid and all of that, as young as we are aware, you know. I think when I was at grade, we were once arrested, you know, at 14 years old. And when this the old court, we were there, we were went to the court and we were released in court at 14 years old, arrested for toitoing in school, you know. So that actually propelled you to say, no, this system, I must take part in this, you know, in the struggle against this.
So I'm wondering, so which year did you complete your matric?
1990.
So that was before Mandela was released.
Yeah. 1990. Come again.
How has things changed for you? If you look back then and you look back now, do you see a change in our communities?
There's two fronts that I can put it. There's two fronts. The first one, you know, the freedom that we got, I think every black child, not only every black child, every activist, even if you were white, you know, and you were conscious about these things. And remember, we didn't only fought for this freedom as black people. We had people that were progressive, people that were, I can talk about Cameron Dartmoor, you know, that and his family, you know, I can go, his mom was in the Black Sesh, and she was a teacher at Nizabweyethu. She gave us English. So all of these people, you know, make sure that there's a change. I mean, from pre-1990 and after 1990, of course, freedom, there will be a change. You know, if you, I always make of this point, if you have to go in the olden days, if you have to go to check us and standing in the queue, and the presenter next to me who Hans comes, then I have to move away from Hans to go in and be served, though I was first in the line. So when you see it after 1994, that no one can stand at the back of me and also wait in the queue like anybody else. So that is something very significantly, you know. And if you leave a town, stay, we couldn't stay on the other side of town, you know, because it was only preserved for a particular, you know, a kind of people, which is predominantly white people. If you walk in the street, you know, in town, then they will see you might, all of you might be suspect because you are black, you know. So those things have moved away. I mean, there is a change in terms of that. But having said that, there's much to be done, you know, because that change is not sufficient, you know. Only the freedom is not sufficient because there's also an issue of economic emancipation, which actually is an underlying challenge in South Africa today. That's where we actually start. That's where the challenge is. That's where the challenge of black people to say, after this freedom, what's there for us in terms of the economy? Yeah. What are we not participating or not? And I said to some people, you know, you look at, I will quickly make this. In Australia, there's two economies. It's instead of two economies, the agriculture and tourism. And if you look, that's the mainstream economy of Australia. And if you look at those economies, in terms of measure of playing, we are non-participant in that economy. You know, we can only be general workers and the sweepers, you know, but we're not participating in terms of saying we are beneficiaries of that sector, of both sector in agriculture and also in tourism, you know. So these are the challenges. Even though we are free, but the economic emancipation is still a challenge for a black child. Moreover, in Australia, you know, I've got cases that I can make example of, you know, in Australia.
For you, sir, that is very interesting what you are talking about freedom and a physical freedom and then economical freedom. Yes. Listeners, luisteraars, ons praat met Vuyisa Voorplay en ons gaan praat oor Black Lives Matter. Vir nou gaan ons gou na 'n musiekbreek toe en as ons terugkom, dan hoop ons het ons 'n WhatsApp van julle af gekry en ons speel uit met Don Hathaway se Black Young and Gifted. So luisteraars, ons is hier by ons het koppe by mekaar. Ek en Hans is vanaand aan die woord. En ons het 'n gas vanaand, Vuyisa Voorplay. Vuyisa, welcome and thank you for joining us today. You're on ons het koppe by mekaar. We'll have to find the English one for that, Hans.
It's right. For my so, right.
So, Vuyisa, we want to talk about during the lockdown. Something emerged in America and a lot of focus was placed on it, called a movement called Black Lives Matter. And for some, it might have been the first time that they've ever heard of this movement, but actually it was born or birthed in 2013 when a young boy called Trayvon Martin visited a friend and he was shot by a white guy, and this guy was actually acquitted. He never got jail time. And then this movement was started by three women. There you go, ladies. Three women started this movement, Black Lives Matter, where they were speaking about the injustices that African American men were facing. And obviously, when we heard about George Floyd now at the end of May, where he died at the hands of an officer, it obviously became, it was a new thing on the news and everybody was talking about it and people were talking everywhere you read Black Lives Matter. So I was wondering, how does that play out in South Africa? Because the American people, the African Americans went through similar things that we went through. How does injustices play out in South Africa? What's your experience? How do you see it?
Look, you see the difference. Let me start here. Say, look, the Black Lives Matter movement. Of course, it's an action that people thought we've been quiet too long. We've been suffocating, you know. And therefore, we need to do something about it. As you correctly highlighted that 2013, then people begin to start the movement. And then George Floyd, then become the hype on that issue of Black Lives that matters, you know. And I think it's about social injustice. It's about police brutality. It's about racism and discrimination. And it's not far from what we've experienced in South Africa. You know, we've experienced that. But fast forward to 1994, where you will see that the government is the government of the majority, but still those signs of racism is still there in South Africa, like you would experience in America. Police brutality, we've seen, for instance, Colin Khoza, that was killed, you know, during the lockdown. You can talk about Marikana as well, that people were murdered that we wouldn't expect from our own that we should. I'm a strong critic of that. I always, you know, though I'm an activist and there's some very sense close to the ANC, but I'm a strong critic to say we cannot be doing the same thing that we've experienced with the apartheid government, you know, of our people. The police brutality, you know, racism that is institutionalized. In South Africa, racism is institutionalized, you know, because we are free, of course, but you look at it, let me take one example. I was just looking at the article where they were giving stats about top management, you know, on this organization, on the CEOs, which give us to say, on the top management, then the 67%, if I'm correct with figures, is white males. that occupy those positions. And then you've got 10% that's Indian. You got around about 5%, 5 point something that is colored, and 15% that is black Africans or black Africans that are in top executive, you know, position in South Africa. And you must ask why do we have still have that at this juncture, at this time, you know, where we're supposed to have turned the wheel, you know, but because these things are institutionalized, and therefore you can say still, you know, that black are not being given the space to show their expertise, you know. And secondly, if you look at the issue of participation also, as I've highlighted before, in the economy, you know, you look if you look at all these sectors where I've raised the issue, I want to bring to Otson for that matter, where I've raised the issue, if you look, there's also about business chamber, you know, a business chamber that I feel if that business chamber would have been conscious of saying, we've been here for so long, and also we want to take these people that has been disadvantaged in the past and put them and assist them to get somewhere, you know? And it's their responsibility, it's human. They should say, it's our responsibility to say, how do we help the black society and make sure they are at a level that way we are, to give them the expertise, to assist them, and also how the government intervene in that space, you know, to make sure that black people, you know, are actually assisted in that space, you know, with those changes, yes.
Well, you see, I'm just thinking, because you're speaking about racism, and we 2020, it's so many years after 1994, does racism ever, is racism always white against black, or does it ever change where it's black against white? Because racism in our minds are always that black people are being ridiculed, or they are pulling at the shortest stick. But does it ever change for you? Have you ever experienced racism from the other way around?
It's quite a beautiful question. I think you need, at some stage you need to define what racism is, you know, and then find in our own context, South African context, and find it really can you be there, because it's got to do for me, it's also got, when you expand it, it's got also got to do with resources, you know, and the space that people protect, you know, and how it's actually the slightest word is that the prejudice. If you speak about prejudice, to say, how am I seeing the next person? And I think somebody said, when it's discussed, somebody said, look, perhaps this is for discussion for another place, to say, black people can never be racist. Hans might have a different view, might raise a different view than the question I'm raising. But I think I also agree in that statement, because I don't think, remember sometimes when you are defensive, you know, and some people, the way they react, because there's a system that has never been dismantled. So when you engage, let's say engaging a white person, engaging hands, and then the first thing, you know, is for me sometimes to attack, you know, not consciously raise that because of racism. Remember, racism is about the color. And I said, I had a chat with my kids in the morning. And we're talking about this. I asked them, I'm going to interview today. Can you tell me what do I say there about racism? You know? And then they break it down. And I said, look, because the issue in racism is that it's not something people that are born with. You know? It's something that people are taught. That's a fundamental. Because I don't remember black people that says, you must not like a white person. You know, the person is not actually to your standard, or you are superior to that person, you know. And I was saying to the kids, you go and I say, you look at it from the other, and you look at how these kids play, you know, black and white, very nice. They're happy. You go to Otho and I, you get that kids are just playing. But then at some stage, later stage, you get that, because some of the parents in white communities, they don't debrief from that space, you know, to say, I do not see color, and think and teach their kids. Because once we get that from white communities, to teach their kids to say, there's nothing, a person is a person, whether from what ethnicity, whether from what race, you know, and that's where you can be able to defeat that, you know. So I think it's entrenched, so, whether it's on prayer and also on institutions, it's entrenched.
So what I hear from you is, your opinion is that racism is obviously not something you're born with.
You're not.
It is something that,
is taught.
You grow up, or you get taught.
Yeah.
And it's about prejudice.
Yeah.
Do I have you right? So together with these Black Lives Matter,
yes.
I mean, obviously there were other sayings going about white lives matter,
yeah.
All lives matter, yeah. Blue lives matter.
Yeah.
And in some of what you've said now, I hear that is also coming through. All lives matter. How do you see us moving away from racism? How do you see us incorporating everybody?
Look, for me, you see, if you look at the Constitution of South Africa, our Constitution, I think it's in the preamble. That says that we want to advocate for a non-racial, non-sexist society.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that is within us. You know, and if white people can embrace that, you know, if they can embrace that, you know, for instance, if I always make this point, you know, we've gone this far, you know, to reach out to people that really do not give us the return, in saying, we've transgressed, and I can say, look, we've done these things to you, you know, and therefore we're reaching out for you to be able to create that society. Because if you can have prejudice and racism in 2020 in South Africa, you know, then you must say, do we have really people that's got conscience? You know, you've oppressed people and you've moved from 1994 to 2020, but there's still people that's prejudiced other people, you know? And you must say, why don't these people find in themselves, you know? The wealth move forward, say, we've done these ills, and we agree we've done these ills. How do we reach out to those communities and make sure that they understand us, that we have moved away from that thinking, you know? Because up until, to be honest with you, that some, not all white people are racist, you must get that, eh? Up until those people that are still have that, you know, feeling or that act of racism realize that really we need to move forward as a country, we move forward for our young people that are coming up to live in a society that knows no race, you know? I still have to see, you know, a black child that goes, let me say, in Osman High, that dates a white kid in Osman. I've never seen that. About it,
I think, Buyisa, I think you will be surprised.
Yes.
I think you will be surprised.
Is that embraced also by the parents? I'm talking about, look, I'm talking about Osman, you know? And I'm talking about Osman. Yeah. Osman's got a history, and I think that mentality and that history hasn't really been swept off. To be honest with you, that's why I still have to see, because I go to town almost every day, to see a black child. When I say a black child, I mean, remember, the definition of black child in South Africa is colored Africans and Indian. When I see a black child there at ShopRite, walking hand in hand with his girlfriend that is white, I have never seen that in Osoran. I have seen that in
Would
Cape
that
Town.
Be something that Would that be something that would be a pinnacle point for you that would mean that we have moved forward?
At least it will show, you know, that there's nothing to, it will show where we move forward, because it shows a step that we're moving forward, you know, that there's a movement towards that, and people are beginning to embrace each other, you know? That's what I want
to ask you. Well, you said, can I ask you, because I've heard you've said earlier on that what you went through, what your family went through,
yeah,
in apartheid, And it must have been very, very traumatic. And I mean, you're just one of many people, of millions of people that have experienced that.
Yeah.
What would people, black people, or people that have suffered at the hand of apartheid, what would they need to do in order to move beyond that pain that they have, that they've received during the years of apartheid? What needs to happen? What do they, as a person, need to do to move forward?
Look, I think I've used a word that says embrace, you know? And I think for me, that becomes the keyword, to see that the other people from the other side of the town embraces that notion, to say we are living and we are working towards that space of non-racialism, you know? For us, I think that's enough, because we do not, you know, people say we keep on going back, but how can you not go back when there's no improvement, there's no change? Because keep on referring, because there's no change. When you see people begin to embrace each other, you know, begin to have, you know, to have a round table and have a discussion about these things and acknowledge to say, look, this is what happened, and therefore we are all in this to move forward to make sure that it doesn't happen again, and there's no prejudice arise, you know, against any race. We are one people, you know. So you there's still that challenge, you know. For instance, let me come to this thing that you did. You see, if you look at farm evictions, they still happen today. You know, if you go to Bongoletu, there's some shack that are built, and all those people that came there from that stay there are actually from the farms, you know, and they've been literally, I think 5 years back, thrown into Bongoletu, and the circle got dropped there with their bags, you know, because they're not welcome anymore in the farms, you know. So these are the challenges that you would not expect. You know, ask a great question, say, but how can you not talk about racism at this age, 2020? But there are traits that are still there, you know. Our people in farms are still ill-treated. I mean, I also had a situation where I thought about, you know, the ease of the coffin where the two farmers, you know, black worker into the coffin, you know. Those still things are still there. It talks to those challenges, you know. And if you look also, let me say this thing. If you look at the courts, you know, how easy, because, you know, people in Okada, to get out of that space and get a 500 bail for killing a black child, you know. And if you would, for instance, kill a white person, you know, will never get out of the jail again, which is supposed to be happening across board. If it has not, because it has to be, if you commit a crime, it must be treated equally, you know.
So can I come in? You know, it's what I mean. I think we want the same thing. We want to live in a fair society, a just society, where people are not treated according to their skin color. And what I'm scared of, you know, like when we push it, it's almost like the whites become even more ingrained, like, you know, withdraw from society, and we have, you use the term consciousness, and it's for me, it's awareness, you know, awareness of what it feels like to be treated according to your skin color and not as a human being. And what I feel what's missing in a conservative town like Oudtshoorn are encounters with people from a diverse background, just so that we can see we're all humans. And in a way, Klankeru Connect and this concert Koppenberg Mekaar is related to that's our dream, is for, you know, people to listen to each other in a way like we're listening to each other now. And I mean, imagine at Oudtshoorn High, a white child can go sleep in Bongoletu over a weekend and have that experience of staying over in the township. And the same, a Bongoletu child can go sleep in Besbank. You know, like this whole, it feels to me, and if we fight with each other, we're not going to get it right. Yeah, and in 50 years' time, we're still going to have this kind of, you know, separate society. And we need to get together for the sake of our children.
It's not supposed to be a taboo. You know, if you can have white people just walking in Bongoletu, two of them, it becomes a taboo, eh? The black people look, what are these people, what do they want here in the township? And they will go out, hey, there's white people in the township. You know, it's not about 2020, it's not supposed to be like that, if you'll agree. 2020, that if you see white people walking in the streets in Bongoletu or in Christian, and then somebody, hey, that's a fat man, silver down, whoop. That's who they. It's not supposed to be like that after these years. It's supposed to be something that's normal occurrence, that if I've gone with somebody at school, because I said somebody that made this point to say, I went to school with this guy, Zwadi was my friend, but when I see him after years, and I wanted to greet him, he didn't even look at me. But we were same class at school. So, you know, if you write hands, if you can help, I think we need a dialogue more than anything. Yeah. And yes. to say, and to encourage that dialogue, you know, and see how do we move
forward. So, Vuyisa, I agree completely with you, because it sounds like you are also saying, and what you and Hans are saying, is that we haven't grown to a familiarity with one another. Everything,
that's correct.
Both, all races are still so unfamiliar with each other and so foreign with each other, and that what we need is a dialogue in order to move forward and to move maybe from Black Lives Matter to All Lives Matter. Unfortunately, Vuyisa, our time is done for tonight. I really want to thank you for coming in and having this conversation with us. Luisteraars, julle kan hierdie opname kyk op Klein Karoo Connect se Facebook page, en volgende week is ons weer terug met ons sit koppe by mekaar. Thank you, Vuyisa, and good night to you. Thank you for coming in.
Baie dankie vir die geleentheid.
Plezier. En dankie, Hans. Thank you.
Thank you,
Luisteraars, ons sien julle volgende week. Volgende week in ons speel uit met Robbie Malinga se Baby Please.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you.